Yes.
Hello?
Yes. Operator? What's that? Calling long distance from Chicago. Yes? Yes? No operator. No, that's the wrong number. I said that's the wrong number. Okay. Thank you. Goodbye. Frickin' telephone. When are they gonna improve these things? It's always Chicago calling me. It's like, I don't know anybody in Chicago. Anyway. Hey, how are you? It's Fran in the lab, yada yada. I was supposed to be flying today, but weather's got the plane grounded, so I got a spare day to make a video. So I thought I'd make a video about my candlestick telephone. I've been wanting to do this for a while. It's kind of like a string of telephone-related videos that I've been meaning to make forever. This one is from around 1915. They made these candlestick phones for decades, and even long after regional pulse dialing became a thing, these candlestick phones remained in lots of households and on lots of desks because they sound great, they work great, and there's really something special about, you know, having, you know, the earpiece up and talking into the microphone. It's just, it's got a weight to it, it's heavy, you know, it's made out of solid brass. Fidelity is really good even today, the great carbon elements. And yeah, so I wanted to show it off up close and talk a little bit about the telephone. So let's go in and take a closer look. It's kind of hard to light this because it's all shiny and brass-like. This one has been fully restored by a company in Canada that they do a really great job. This is the Western Electric Company, and patents listed there. August 16th, 1904, September 13th, 1904, and January 26th, 1915. You'll notice that there's no dial on this because these designs predate pulse dialing, although, you know, if you go to the Wikipedia page, you'll say, oh, pulse dialing goes back to the 1800s. Well, yeah, I mean, the concept of it does, but in principle, automatic regional pulse dial exchanges, I mean, they started cropping up in, originally, like in major cities, large hotels, large office buildings and stuff like that, where if they, for whatever reason, didn't want to have an operator, you could have a dial phone and it would, you know, it would help condense calls coming out of small areas, but pretty much throughout the early 20th century, when you picked up the receiver, you expected to talk to an operator who was going to connect you to a number or a person or a city, and when you lifted up the receiver, a light would come on at the local exchange for your line, and some people got in the habit of lifting the receiver and then just clicking the receiver so that rather than just one light coming on among many thousands of lights, you'd see a blinking light and you would get the attention of the operator sooner than if you just lifted up the receiver. But yeah, you would call an operator who would be sitting at a console full of possible connections with panels of jacks and wires and sockets and lights and everything. It was a major, major operation to have telephone exchanges, and it was a major job. You know, most operators were women, although it was not, you know, beyond exception to have men as operators too. But lots and lots of people were employed as operators because it was a job that paid pretty well. It was hard work, but required 24-hour attendance. So it was one of the few jobs in the early 20th century, besides like coal mining, that would have three shifts. You know, you could work overnight and, you know, but yeah, so very interesting. But yeah, interesting thing too about candlestick phones, and so I'm going to turn it around. Most candlestick phones you find today, this one is not, but most candlestick phones that you find today that are still in existence, they'll usually have like a hole drilled up here in the top of the receiver, or down here in the neck. There usually be like some kind of hole drilled in here. And that's because most of the candlestick phones that survived into the late 20th century survived as lamps, because there was sort of a fad in the 50s of taking candlestick phones, which were literally free, you know, in the 50s, and converting them into lamps by, you know, drilling this out and putting a bolt in and then attaching a lamp fixture above. And the candlestick phones made great lamp bases because they're so heavy and you really can't topple them over. And like I said, they're solid brass. So so many of these phones were converted into lamps as novelty lamps. And, you know, it would sit there, it would hang the receiver on it. And you could even hook up the switch so that when you took the receiver off, the light would come on. And when you hang the receiver up, the light would go off. The 1950s was really like rife with novelty kinds of lamps and all kinds of things, converting things old kitsch. And so the so many of these candlestick phones were converted into lamps, and the remainder like recycled for the brass, especially during the wars. That in the late 20th century, pretty much the majority of candlestick phones that still existed were ones that had been made into lamps. And so a lot of those got converted back into phones when these phones became collectible again. So it's just one of those really weird pieces of trivia. But this one has been fully restored. It's got all new cabling. The original cables were long tattered, but the reproduction woven cables, they look very good. They're made with the same kind of cotton weave, you know, kind of rough cotton weave. It's got the right feel and everything, although you can definitely feel that it's PVC wire underneath. You can feel the braided PVC wire. The original wires for these phones could be strangely stiff because there were so many layers to the old wiring, you know, layers of, you know, around the wires themselves would be, you know, wrapped a layer of asbestos, usually for flame proofing, and then a rubber coated sleeve, and then usually a cloth binding around that, and then an outer cover jacket, and then like an outer woven cover just for, you know, abrasion resistance and stuff. But there were many, many, many layers to those old cables that you'd have to cut through and get through to get to the conductor. This one, you heard it ringing, and that's because it's got a ring module. The company that restored this phone, they also converted an old Western Electric wall mount ringer with a little converter. Real brass bells, and the little striker there in the middle. Striker, 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 striker! This isn't your typical kind of solenoid setup. This is actually like a transformer that is stepping the 90 volt 20 hertz pulse signal that comes from the telephone exchange. That's why you have to have this converter as a modern converter for this. But the landline ringer systems operated about, well, there's 48 volt DC, but to ring the phone, they would put on the same line, on that DC line, they would put a 90 volt 20 hertz pulse just to ring the ringer. And then when you picked up the receiver, the exchange would sense that the receiver switch was on and it would cut off the AC voltage. But let me ring it. I'll show you the ringer in action here. It's kind of weird. When I hook this up to my landline, along with the other phones, it sort of, this particular phone kind of acts like its own line. Probably has to do with this converter they have in there. But yeah, it's extremely simple, electromechanical, but very effective. So in rural areas where you didn't necessarily have electrical power, in order to make a call, you would often have a wall-mounted magneto where you would run a crank, and that crank would send out a 90-volt pulse to the exchange to alert the operator. And then when they patched you in, your phone would operate and you'd have the voltage. But yeah, it's like I said, even after they had pulse dial exchanges were, you know, pretty common and ubiquitous, so many people had grown up with the candlestick phone and with the idea too that you're used to having an operator do the work for you. You know, why look it up in the phone book when you can, you know, just talk to the operator, ask the operator to connect you to so-and-so. Now, of course, as time went on, operators became eliminated for, you know, local calling, and were really relegated to long-distance calling and exchanges. And that led up to the area code, which after the area code, the entire system was automated, and you can dial long-distance and local with your own dialer. But it took quite a long time for the operator to not be a fixture in telephone communication. But yeah, with all the advances in telephone, quotes, technology, I mean, yes, I've got a smartphone, everyone has a smartphone, but this is not a telephone. You can use it kind of as a telephone, but in my mind, this is a telephone. And it's a different experience to actually talk on one of these. I actually look forward to people calling my landline, even when it's a wrong number, because I just like the idea of being able to pick up the phone, put the earpiece on, and talk into the microphone. And it's an experience, you know? And I can really appreciate the people who grew up with these phones really lamenting the loss of them, you know, when they had to, you know, hand in their beloved candlestick for a dial rotary phone because there was no longer an operator to connect them. And I can understand the feelings involved with something so tactile and beautiful as a real, genuine, authentic, actual telephone. All right, well, there you go. All right, that's it for this one. Thanks for watching. Thanks too to everyone on the Patreon for making all these videos possible. It's true. I would not be able to make any of these videos without them, and especially since I'm officially on hiatus. I'm not really supposed to be making videos because I'm supposed to be flying because I'm in flight school. But like I said, there will be days when, you know, the plane's grounded because I don't have an instrument rating, so when it's too inclement, I'm on the ground. So anyway. Also, people were asking about, you know, if I had a GoFundMe for the flight school project, and I do. If you go into the description, I do have a GoFundMe there if you want to put a few pennies in for this expensive project. You'll have my thanks. And just kind of as a topper for this, unrelated, people were asking, because I did the video about these really great edge-lit displays. So many people were saying, why don't you show it with the lens on in full brightness? Well, as I leave, I will give you that. The KGM edge-lit display at full brightness with the red filter in. Enjoy. Berserk. my lab. It's where I work. So people are going to say, why don't you tear it down? Well, there's really nothing to tear down, but I am curious. I'm going to take the face cover off so we can take a look at the carbon element. Definitely don't want to strip out 100-year-old screws. All right, original 100-year-old brass screws. Slotted, of course. There's really nothing to see. I mean, it's just, there it is. It's just, yeah. And yeah, see, they've insulated that and everything. They've got a little pad on the back for vibration. Yeah, it's PVC wire. But yeah, that's the original carbon element in there. They did a really good job. I mean, that's a really solid casting in the front there. Brass casting. Just, wow, it's just so solidly done, really. Yeah, I have to say, they really did a great job in Canada. It's Canadian telephone restorers really do a good job. But yeah, there's very little to see. It's just very simple. Yeah, you don't want to cross thread something like that. And yeah, with brass, it's important just to make it finger tight. You don't torque down on brass. It's not like steel. All right, back together.